Today we're talking about the doctrine of Christ. Next Tuesday, don't forget, we will meet at 1 o'clock. In the first hour, we will talk about the doctrine of the Holy Spirit. The second hour, we will have the final exam. I do, again, encourage all of you to take the final exam, study the materials for it. I think that you'll learn more, and you don't need to worry about anything. There's no downside to taking the test. So today, we are talking about the doctrine of Christ, or, to use the theological word, Christology. Every doctrinal area has a name. Next week, we'll talk about the doctrine of the Holy Spirit, which is called pneumatology. Pneuma is the Greek word for spirit, or wind, also breath. When you talk about sin, it's called hamartiology. We'll get into that next term when we get into the rest of systematic theology. Obviously, when you talk about humanity, it's the doctrine of anthropology. You all know anthropology. You probably have had classes in that. But that is the term for the study of humanity, including in a theological sense. So what is Christology? Christology, or the doctrine of Christ, is the study of the person, nature, and work of Jesus Christ, especially as reflected in the New Testament. And you will note, this is the most important issue of Christian theology. What you believe about the person and nature of Jesus makes or breaks the deal. If you ever wonder if a particular religious group or religious person or philosophy is Christian or not, there is only one question you have to ask. What do they say about Jesus? You can be loosey-goosey on everything else, but if you don't get it right about the nature of Jesus, his person, his nature, his work, then it doesn't fit. And I'm not saying that people don't have a right to believe whatever they want to believe, but if someone says to you, well, I believe Jesus was a great teacher and a fine man, but he wasn't really God, they can't be a Christian. And they're not very smart. We'll talk about that in a few minutes, that you can't really say that, and if you've thought about it at all, and paid attention to what Scripture says about it. So, the issue of who Jesus was and is the most fundamental issue that we will address in this class or that you will ever address in any Christian study, okay? Christology is particularly concerned with the relationship of the nature and person of Jesus with God the Father. In other words, we get back somewhat to the Trinity. What is the nature of the relationship between Jesus the Son and God the Father? And then the details of Jesus' ministry, acts, and teaching, so that we can arrive at a clearer understanding of who he is and how it is that he provides our salvation. Now, there's so much stuff here. I'm going to break this up into pieces. Next term, I'm going to start out with the doctrine of providence, which I had to sort of skip over this time, because the doctrine of providence gets, the sharp point of that gets to the issue of salvation. Well, related to the issue of salvation, are issues of atonement, how did Jesus atone for our sins, of propitiation, how did Jesus make it possible for us to be, again, for the Father to be propitious toward us, meaning favor toward us. And so next term, I'm going to start with the doctrine of providence, and then I'm going to go to the doctrine of atonement. And in that discussion, I'm going to get more into the soteriology. Soteriology is the doctrine of salvation. How is it that we are saved by Jesus? So some of that we're not going to be able to get to today. There's just too much. But next term, we will get into salvation, providence of God, how it is that Jesus atones for us and is the propitiation for our sins, and how we are saved.
When does next term start?
Next term is in 4 days. No. Next term starts in the first of April, first week in April. Next week I will give you exact dates, but it will be April, May, will be in the first week in April.
The first Friday in April.
Well, this class will be the first Friday in April, yes, Systematics 2. And then it will be April, May, but there will be a spring break. The first week in May we will not meet because Carol and I have another obligation. Okay, we're going to be on a cruise ship again. We have a friend who's doing her 60th birthday celebration. She's going on a 5-day cruise from San Diego to Vancouver, British Columbia, and we agreed to go with her because she's one of our longtime friends. So we'll be doing that. But so we'll deal with a lot of the soteriology, the salvation, which has to do with atonement and all of that, the nature of Christ as that allows us to be saved, because of our faith in Him, and that will relate to the nature of humanity, it will relate to the nature of sin, martyrology. All of that's coming up in the next episode, all right, the next term, so we'll get into that. And it's like you almost have to say all of that at once, because it's all so interwoven, but we'll have to deal with it a topic at a time, okay? So how does He provide our salvation? We will deal that with, we'll touch on that today, because we have to, about the nature of Jesus, but we will get into that more in the next term. Another way you can look at this is to ask the question, how is it that Jesus was both human and divine, and how is that important for our salvation? If Jesus were just divine, He could not have saved us. Certainly if He was just human, He could not have saved us. When we talk about the nature of Jesus, the thing we need to recognize, the most critical part of it, is that Jesus was fully human and fully divine. Not 80-20, not 50-50, not 40-60. This is one of the mysteries of our faith, and we recognize it as a mystery. He was fully God and fully human. If He had been any less of either one, we would not be able to be saved by His act on our behalf. Okay, now, when we talk about Him being fully God and fully human, because this is so much an important part of our belief, you know, it is the critical belief in Christianity, it is the thing that people have gotten wrong most often, partly because it's a mystery. There have been so many attempts to try to explain this that failed in one direction or another. They either have emphasized the deity of Christ at the expense of His humanity, or they've emphasized the humanity of Christ at the expense of His deity. Either one of those goes wrong. In fact, the great heresies of the Christian faith, the great getting it wrongs, the great mistakes that have been made about our faith have almost all been related, the important ones at least, have been related to the doctrine of Christology. What did they think was the nature of Jesus? And I want to talk about that a little bit in terms of some of those errors. These are often called the Christological controversies. In fact, I have a book, the whole book. It's called The Christological Controversies, because there have been so many ways in which people have gotten this wrong. And there's some stuff on your study notes about this, okay, because I prepared that knowing we were going to get here. One of the beginning of the first century and really blooming in the second century, heresies about the nature of Jesus was called Gnosticism. There are a couple of different beliefs of Gnosticism. One of them is that the real point of life is knowledge, that there is a secret knowledge. That's what gnosis means, Gnosticism. The other part, the other main doctrine of Gnosticism, is that all matter is evil. All physical material is evil. Only spiritual things are good. Well, if they believe that all physical things are evil, then they did not believe if Jesus was the Messiah. Now, they didn't believe He was divine, but they thought He was sent by God, that He was a great spirit sort of thing, that He could not have actually been physical, that the humanity of Jesus was just an appearance. Jesus only appeared to be human. So that was one of the mistakes, the Christological error of Gnosticism. They had a bunch of other wacky things too, but that was the big mistake. Out of Gnosticism developed sort of a broader, it started with Gnosticism and then kind of opened up into what is called Docetism. Docetism is from the Greek word which means to appear. Docetism said that God could not really have become flesh, God can't suffer, and so therefore Jesus only appeared to be human. He was not really human. This is sort of what I was suggesting when I, you know, that they were saying that Jesus was similar to what we might say about angels, that He only took on an appearance but wasn't really human. Now, we're going to talk later about what Scripture says and what the belief is, but I want you to have some idea how much people have struggled with this and how often they've gotten it wrong. A third view was Ebionism. We know the Ebionites as being the Judaizers of Paul's day because they were Jewish, and they believed that you had to follow the Jewish law, including to be circumcised. That's what they're called, the circumcision party in places. But another part of what they believed is they did not believe that Jesus could be the Messiah if He was in any way mortal, because God can't be mortal, because they were Jewish, and they maintained the Jewish law. So they said, again, they were a kind of Docetism, because they said Jesus was, you know, He appeared as a human being, He wasn't really God, because there's only one God. They thought it was you know, that they split it all up. And they said, God is God, Jesus couldn't be God. So they didn't accept him as being the second person of the Trinity, as we understand it. We then have adoptionism, the idea that Jesus was born human, just one of us. And then when he was baptized, and we have the image where the Holy Spirit descended on him like a dove, and the voice of God the Father from heaven said, "This is my Son in whom I am well pleased," that at that point, Jesus took on divinity. I think I've told you all the story that a guy that used to come to my classes in Seattle came up to me one day and said, "You know, I really want to have coffee with you because I think I found something really important." We got together at the coffee shop, and he said, "I figured it out. Jesus was just a human until his baptism, and you know, the Spirit came down and he became divine then. That answers all the questions." And I went, "Actually, it doesn't." that is a belief called adoptionism, and it's been around since the very early days, and it's always been considered a heresy. And it very much upset him. He thought he had figured out the secret of the universe all on his lonesome. And when I told him, "I'm sorry, but no, you're not the first one to come up with that, and it's not right," he just couldn't take it. You know, he was very upset about it, very angry. He left, and you know, I don't think I ever saw him again in class. But he thought he'd figured it out. another one is called modalism, the idea that God is only one God, but that he appears at different times in the modes of either the Father or the Son or the Holy Spirit. Somebody had said it's almost like God, like a football game. God the Father played the first half, and in the third quarter, he sent in Jesus, scored a few touchdowns, and then in the fourth quarter, the Holy Spirit came in and cleaned it up with a few field goals, all right? But they didn't all play at the same time. That is not the doctrine of the Trinity. The Trinity says that all three persons, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, have all three existed simultaneously throughout all eternity. And so when Jesus came as the Son, it in no way detracted from or subtracted from the presence of God the Father or the Holy Spirit. So modalism, not right. We then have Arianism. Arianism was a doctrine of Arius at the start of the 4th century, the 300s. He was an elder, and he started proposing that God the Father was the only part of the Trinity that had always existed, and that the Son and the Spirit were created as the first acts of creation by God the Father. And the statement was, as Arian put it, speaking of Jesus and the Holy Spirit, but the question especially related to Jesus, Arius said there was a time when he was not, he being Jesus. So the idea that he was not co-eternal. The whole Council of Nicaea and the Nicene Creed was in response to the Arian heresy. And he was declared a heretic, that Jesus has always existed, he was not created by the Father. There is one God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that are all co-eternal.
Is Ebionism, is that always Jewish people?
Well, it was then. I mean, it doesn't exist anymore. Okay. But in Paul's time, they were the ones that Paul writes against in Galatians. They're the ones that he mentions in the pastoral letters as creating problems, wanting to demand that Gentile Christians be circumcised. That's the part we read about that Paul was really dealing with. They were the legalists. They were the ones that said you had to obey the Mosaic law. But in addition to that, because they were strict Jews and didn't want to have any suggestion of more than one God, they did not accept Jesus as being divine because they didn't have a clear idea of what the Trinity means.
You're
God.
Saying that doesn't exist anymore?
No, it doesn't. I mean, there may be people who still, I'm sure they still maintain that idea, but in terms of a movement, or a school, they were organized then. You know, people would say, "Yes, you know, I'm an Ebionite," meaning that I believe this. I don't think anybody would call themselves that anymore, although some people may still maintain that doctrine. Yes?
Do all of these stem out of Christianity? I mean, certainly some of them do, but like Gnosticism, did that exist before?
Gnosticism began as a philosophy, but very quickly became a Christian heresy, a Christian cult.
Right.
So, Christian Gnosticism. Now, most people who study the history of this philosophies and religions and stuff would say that Gnosticism didn't really occur until the second century. And they would say we have no evidence on it. Well, then we read in several of Paul's books where he's clearly addressing the question of Gnosticism. Incretism, which we talked about in the letters of Paul the other day, in the pastoral letters, he says people who say that you may not be married, and who say that certain foods cannot be eaten, that was a doctrine of the Incretists, who were Gnostics. Well, they say, well, there's no evidence of Gnosticism until the second century. And we go, well, look at this. There's two or three places where Paul very clearly is talking about Gnosticism. And they go, oh, then Paul, you know, Paul must not know what he's talking about because they didn't come along until the second century. And I'm going, what? You know, you've got evidence right here, and yet you deny it. And some people would say, well, that's proof that Paul didn't write until the second, you know, look, these letters were not written by Paul. They didn't come along until the second century. Instead of saying there's an indication there was at least a nascent, which means an infant form, a beginning form of Gnosticism in the middle of the first century, which most evangelical scholars would say, absolutely, there's pretty clear proof of that from what Paul wrote, okay? So, and Gnosticism continues today. We call it the New Age movement. Very much so. A lot of the similarities, you know, the spirit, finding the God which is in you, which basically was a personal thing. You know, if you have the, if you're one of the elect that has the secret knowledge, then, you know, all of that. We then have Apollinarianism, which said that Jesus had a divine mind, but only a human body. Okay, it split his body and mind in two. Then we have Nestorianism. Most of these things, by the way, came out from officers of the church. They were elders, they were presbyters, they were bishops, you know, various others. Nestorianism suggested that Jesus was born only human, that he adopted a divine nature, but that he ended up with two very distinct natures. He was sort of bifurcated. There was a divine nature in him that came later and a human nature, but they were not one. Then you have Eutychianism, which said that the two natures, the human and divine, mixed and became some third quantity. It's like you take a glass of water and dribble some ink into it. You no longer have pure water, you no longer have pure ink, you've got something new and different. That's what Eutychianism says. And then Monophysitism said that the divine nature completely absorbed the human, so only the divine was left. Pelagianism, Pelagius was one of the other heretics, that there's no such thing as original sin, though, so therefore we didn't need to be saved from our sin, and Jesus, therefore, was not a divine savior. He was just a wise teacher, etc., etc. Now, why in the world am I giving you all this? Almost every one of these errs in one direction or the other. They either deny, as I said before, the humanity of Jesus in favor of him being only divine, or they deny the divinity of Jesus in favor of him only being a really smart human. Neither one of those options have ever been found acceptable as doctrine for the church. Okay? The doctrine of the church, which we're going to talk about in detail in a few minutes, is that Jesus was fully God and fully human, two natures, divine nature, human nature, together in one person. Very similar to the fact that the Trinity is three persons in one God. Jesus was two natures, human and divine, in one person. And I'll read to you from the Creed of Chalcedon, or the Chalcedonian Creed in a minute, and from the Athanasian Creed, two of the creeds that specifically address the nature of that combining, well, or that bringing together two natures in one person. Okay? What we do know, you know, we go from there, we look at Scripture. Scripture tells us that Jesus was God incarnate. That he really was God come in the flesh. Incarnate means in the flesh. Incarnate, like chili con carne, with meat. That's what incarnate means, in the flesh. All right? And I give you a number of scripture verses there. We're also told Jesus was miraculously born of a virgin. All right? That he was, it was a miracle. He was a product of the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, and a human woman. There was a divine aspect and a human aspect to it. Now, a couple of verses, which we hear all the time, some of these, or at least one of these, in every Christmas we hear it, and we never really think about what it means. Isaiah 9:6 says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." You all read that on Christmas cards every year, right? But think about what it means when it says, "For to us a child is born." People, humans get born. "To us a son is given." That's one of the scriptures that if you think about what it says, he was born as a human, but he was given or sent by God the Father. He's human and he's divine. That's why it says it that way. To us a son is born, to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. Another passage, Galatians 4, 4 to 5 says, and when the time had fully come, that means when the time is perfect, or in the fullness of time, if you know the King James, when the time had fully come, God sent forth his son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who are under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. You'll notice God sent forth his son, born of a woman, divine and human. Scripture is full of those kinds of references that tell us that Jesus was divine and he was human. He was God incarnate. He was miraculously born of a virgin. He was the divine creator. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. John 1. He is Lord. Lord, in fact, Kyrios, the Greek, is the most popular name that Paul has for Jesus, but it's not exclusive to Paul. But he was also fully human. And these passages, I'm going to get to the Hebrews passage a little bit later and talk about it, when it says that the only way he could save us is to be made fully like us, fully human. So you read in Scripture, and there are places it's clearly saying Jesus is divine. We're going to talk about the titles that Jesus accepted for himself in a bit. But also places where it makes it very clear he was born of a woman, he was fully human, and that was necessary for our salvation. So you've got this tension. He was God, he was human, he was both. Right? Now, the issues of all those heresies. Yes?
So was that difficult for the Hebrew people to comprehend that duality?
That's been difficult for everybody to comprehend, even up till today.
But, you know, in times when, like the Roman gods and that, they were part spiritual beings, but very physical attributes too. So I wondered if this was really such a burden for them as it is for us.
The Jews had a special problem with this, because the idea that God could become a human being was not within their ability to understand. God was wholly other. They perceived God as the one on whom you cannot even look without being destroyed. So how could he become a person? This is one of the biggest problems the Jews had and still have with it. They believe by us saying that Jesus was divine, the Son of God, part that we're advocating multiple gods, multiple deities. That's what the Muslims say about Christians too. But that's not what we're saying. You know, that's a very superficial perception. But everybody had a problem with this. Okay? The Jews probably more than anybody else. In fact, C.S. Lewis in Mere Christianity, I'm going to quote Mere Christianity in a few minutes, he talks about the fact that when Jesus came along and he said he was able to forgive sins, for instance. And as Lewis writes beautifully, he says, now we're not talking about someone who forgives sins committed against him. If you rob me and I forgive you, that's understandable. I can do that. Or if you trod on my toe and I forgive you, that's understandable. But what would you think of someone who forgives everyone for trotting on other people's toes and stealing other people's money? What right could he possibly claim to be able to forgive sins that were committed against other people and not against him? The very fact that he would make a claim like that puts him in a completely different category. You know, the fact that he allowed himself, people say, oh, he didn't call himself the Son of God, he called himself the Son of Man. Well, the Son of Man from Daniel 7, that's where that reference came from, and everybody, all the Jews would have known it, is that the Son of Man is the one who will be given all power and authority and dominion, and his kingdom will be an everlasting kingdom that will have no end. The Son of Man in Daniel 7 is a divine being. So when Jesus called himself the Son of Man, the Jews understood that he wasn't just calling himself a person. He allowed other people readily to call him the Son of God, and he never corrected them. He never said they were wrong. And again, Lewis in Mere Christianity says, now, if someone who was part of a pagan religion or a mystery religion or, you know, anything else had called themselves the Son of God, it would not have been a big deal. But the fact that Jesus was a Jew and he was talking to Jews, it could not be anything but a big deal, because these are people who had a conception of God that did not allow for that. Now, it's why when the high priest asked Jesus at his trial, are you the Son of God? And Jesus said, I am, and you shall see the Son of Man, you know, because he uses both those there. You'll see the Son of Man coming on the clouds in glory. And the high priest does what? He tears his robes, which was a sign of having heard blasphemy. Blasphemy is to make oneself like God. The high priest knew absolutely that Jesus was claiming divinity. There's no question about that. And for the Jews, of all the people that he might have gone to, he could have gotten away with it being just some sort of New Agey kind of suggestive thing anywhere else, but not with the Jews. The fact that he was a Jew who said it to the Jews means there could be no mistake that he was talking about something unbelievably radical in claiming to be God himself, the Son of the living God, okay? So, it's a particular kind of expression to have said that amongst the Jewish people. Now, because of these controversies in the early church, the issue over was he really divine, was he fully human, what was his relationship with God the Father, a number of the major councils, that is, ecumenical gatherings, where all of the church, or virtually all of the church at different times, sent representatives to solve problems, to answer questions, to deal with these controversies. The Christological controversies were the object of more church councils and more theological debates and doctrinal disputes than any other kind of question. You know, they did not spend a lot of energy on figuring out, do you sprinkle or dunk? You know, or et cetera, et cetera. You know, the other doctrinal things. But the nature of and person of Jesus was a focus of a lot of it. As I said before, the Council of Nicaea and the Nicene Creed was called to deal with the Arian heresy by Arius. And that Nicene Creed, which is still the most popular creed of the Christian faith from the early 300s, it established the doctrine of the Trinity with Jesus as the co-eternal, only begotten Son of God. The Nicene Creed, of course, has three parts. You know, we believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible, and all things seen and unseen. And then it goes on and says, and we believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, begotten of the Father. And so, and then it goes on to the Holy Spirit. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. So it laid out the Trinity, and in doing so, it answered Arius by saying, Jesus Christ is co-eternal with the Father, not made by him. Of one being with the Father, begotten, not made. That phrase is exactly pointed at Arius and his heresy. So you understand, these things don't just pop out of nowhere. They were specific. Every word in that document was written to address questions and controversies of that day. I should have popped that up here so we could talk about that more specifically. Then in AD 381, a little less than 60 years later, we had the First Council of Constantinople, which was against Apollinarius. It affirmed that the Council of Nicaea and the Nicene Creed and established that Jesus was fully human and that he had a human mind and soul, whereas Apollinarius had said that Jesus had a divine mind and a human body. So what were they saying? They were affirming that he was fully human as well as being fully divine. Apollinarius was one of the people that made the mistake of trying to split him up and say part was divine and part was human. Body human, mind divine. AD 431, the First Council of Nicaea was against Nestorius and the Nestorian heresy. It established that Jesus had two natures in one person, not two persons. Nestorius and the Nestorians sort of thought, you know, Jesus is schizophrenic. There's two, in effect, two different beings residing in him, one divine and one human. And they said, no, he's one being, one person, and that he has two natures, a divine nature and a human nature. And if you read the stuff from Grudem this week, Grudem goes, you know, at great length talking about the human nature and the divine nature, and that's one of the places he goes wrong, as I'll tell you in a few minutes. They also affirm that Jesus had been fully divine when he was born, but that he was born of a woman. So he was born a human, but was divine from the moment of birth. They identified Mary as the Theotokos. Mary was the God-bearer. And they gave Mary that credit more than anything else in order to attach a qualification to Jesus that he was divine from the moment of birth. He didn't become divine later. And then the Council of Chalcedon was against Eutychus, and it established that Jesus was fully divine and fully human, two natures in one person, not a hybrid, not ink and water, not one new thing. and there are various other things. I mention all this to let you know historically, there has been no, there's no other issue or topic or doctrine or theological concern that has received more attention and more effort in the history of the church than the issue of what is the nature and person of Jesus. Why? Because it's the most important one. Rich?
When did the apostles finally realize that Jesus was fully divine?
Well, let's see. Thomas realized that. Somewhere along the way, the first indication, clear indication we have in Scripture is when Jesus had sent the 12 out and they were healing and driving out demons, and they came back really jazzed. And he said, well, who do people say that I am now that you've been out there talking to everybody? And they say, well, some say that you're Elijah, some say that you're one of the other prophets, da 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 da. And he said, and who do you say I am? And Peter, always the first one to talk, Peter said, you are the Christ, which means the anointed one, the Messiah. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus didn't correct him. What did Jesus say? Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, because it was not a human that told you this, but rather God in heaven.
So that was Peter.
That was Peter. That testimony of Peter is considered a very important stage in the development of the apostles, because that was the first place that we have any of them openly acknowledging him as being divine. But then he gets crucified. And they're all in hiding, thinking they're going to be in trouble too, and clearly at that moment they were not very convinced of his divinity. Well, when he shows up resurrected, they kind of buy into it again. But the ones who didn't see him, like Thomas, did not see him in the first appearance, and he said, yeah, I'm going to believe he's resurrected when I can stick my finger in his hand and my hand in his side. And sure enough, Jesus showed up and said, Thomas, and by the way, don't blame Thomas. Thomas was only asking for the same thing that everybody else had already seen, already got. It was exactly the same. He wasn't asking for anything anybody else didn't get. So the whole doubting Thomas thing is a bad rap. Well, when Jesus said, Thomas, come over here and put your finger in my hand and your hand in my side. And what did Thomas do? He falls on his face and says, my Lord and my God. That's when he knew that he was divine. So I don't think there's one answer to that question. At various places along the way, and it wasn't like they just reached that conclusion and stayed there. You know, they did this a lot, and it wasn't
like our faith.
Exactly, it's just like us. I mean, these were people after all. And the fact is that until the resurrected Jesus spent time with them and taught them, and then was seen to ascend into heaven, I don't think until that moment did it really absolutely sink in. And then, even then, not till the Holy Spirit came right after that in Acts 2. The appearance of the Holy Spirit in Acts 2 is the thing that, you know, the Holy Spirit is the teacher, the encourager, the comforter. And so I think that all of the affirmation of that really, really didn't lock itself into their hearts and minds until the Holy Spirit came. John?
Ross, all of this is just, it just helps us, you know, kind of define where the borders are and not repeat what has happened in the past. And it also, you know, shows us really how these things were hammered out, deliberately hammered out a long, long time that we take for granted today.
Yeah.
Having said that, I got a question, and I want you to help me with this.
Okay.
I understand that Jesus is co-eternal with the Father. I understand that he has no beginning. But we see that, and help me with this now, I see that more predominantly through John's first chapter, where he talks about the Word was in the beginning and the Word was God, and it was finally dressed with flesh, and we saw him beheld his glory. We talk of being born, we talk about given, which implies a start. I don't want to go beyond these boundaries. But
no, I don't think it does. Let me just say, given doesn't mean there was a start. Jesus had always existed, and God the Father gave him to us. Doesn't mean that was the place he started.
Here's my point. When I see Jesus, I see him referred to as the Word of God that existed for eternity.
Mm-hmm.
Then Jesus was born, and he was bestowed a name. He was given a name.
Right.
Now, he exists forever now, sitting at the right hand of his Father, bearing the scars of his wounds, and will be the center of the universe and the glory of all creation.
Right.
But before his birth, where do we, how do we substantiate that this man, God, Jesus, existed before his birth? What distinguishes this between the Word of God? Was it the same, which I'm assuming, you know, we address it like that, or am I wrong in saying, this is going to be a really shocker, so help me, this is why I'm asking you this, that in the beginning was the Word, and Jesus was born, and he was given flesh so that he could die for our sins and obey the Father, and today that name is esteemed above every name
right.
above heaven on earth. And abides forever.
Move along, I guess.
Well, my question is, are we looking at the same? I don't.
Okay.
Am I wrong in saying Jesus did not exist before his birth? The Word existed for all eternity. God sent the Word, put it in the womb of a woman, gave him flesh. Where this we got this man of 23 chromosomes of God, 23 chromosomes of man, the God-man, who then was the perfect sacrifice and now dwells forever.
Jesus did not exist before he was born of Mary. In other words, the incarnate, the human Jesus, was born of Mary. The Son of God, the Word, as John calls him, has always existed. The Trinity of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, has always existed. He did not exist as Jesus, the incarnate one, until he was born of Mary. At that point, the Word of God, the Son of God, became incarnate as a human being. So all of the part of him that was the divine Word, the Son of God, still was there. That's the fully divine part.
Exactly. Exactly.
He became human at the birth. You know, Guillermo and I were talking about this at one point. Jesus, the human man that had that name, did not exist before he was born of Mary.
Exactly.
But the divine part of him has always existed. In the beginning was the Word. And by the way, Word in John 1 is the Greek word logos. And it actually reflects Greek philosophy, because logos to the Greeks meant reason and the essence of being, you know, the very thing that organizes all that is real. That's what the word logos meant to Greek philosophers. You can read Philo about that, first century and a Jewish philosopher who wrote in Greek, he's from Alexandria. So in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Divine, co-eternal. The same was in the beginning with God. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. And he goes on down, he introduces John, and then he goes down and says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only. And then he goes on to talk about Jesus. And so this Word, who is co-eternal, in the beginning he existed with God, he was God, he became flesh. At the moment he became flesh in Mary, he took the name Jesus and took an incarnate form, a human form, divine and human, and he, by his will, chooses to keep that form for all eternity from then on. The Son of God, the Word, from the moment of his birth with Mary, maybe from the conception, depending on how you want to count it, until the end of eternity, meaning forever, will be one being with two natures. He will have the divine nature, that is the Word of God, eternal with the Father, co-eternal with the Father, the Son of God, and the human incarnate Jesus. And he will return in that way.
Are you saying that Jesus didn't look like Jesus before he became incarnate?
He didn't look like anything. He was a spirit.
He was the Word.
Spirit.
Yeah. Okay? In the same way that, you know, Scripture says, you know, God is a spirit, and we must worship him in spirit and in truth. Well, until the incarnation, when Jesus became a human being, born of Mary, he was spirit, just as God the Father and the Holy Spirit are. But he, the second person of the Trinity, became incarnate of the Virgin Mary. That's the point at which he became two natures, divine and human, in one being.
This puts everything in a tangible perspective. You know,
I hope so.
That makes Jesus that much more precious. You know, when you ask somebody who lives in your heart, and they say Jesus, well, really, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, receiving the glory of his creation.
Yeah.
Who lives in my heart is the Spirit of Jesus, the Holy Spirit of Jesus. So it puts Jesus in that context of distinction that to me esteems him
okay.
Lord of Lords and King of Kings.
Absolutely. Now, All of this, all of those heresies, all of the efforts of the church, the most complete statement about the nature and person of Jesus is from the Chalcedonian Creed. And the expression that we use now to sum this up is called the hypostatic union. Everybody say it with me. Hypostatic union. This is perhaps the most critical of all Christian doctrines. The hypostatic union is the belief that Jesus, the divine Son of God, who was the Word from the beginning, that he took on human nature, yet at the same time remained fully God. Fully God, fully human, two natures in one person. Okay? This is the way that it reads in the Chalcedonian Creed. And this gives you some idea why we don't quote this in church. Right? It's the Chalcedonian Creed. It's much longer than the Nicene Apostles. It says, the same perfect in Godhead and also perfect in manhood, that is the same being Jesus, was perfect in Godhead. Godhead is the Trinity. Godhead is the expression of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit together. Okay? The same perfect in Godhead and also perfect in manhood, truly God and truly man, of a reasonable, meaning rational, soul and body, consubstantial or coessential with the Father according to the Godhead, and consubstantial with us according to the manhood, meaning fully God, fully human, in all things likened to us without sin. So he was suffered everything we suffered, but without sin, as we say in the communion service. Begotten before all ages of the Father according to the Godhead, and in these latter days for us and for our salvation, born of the Virgin Mary. It's just what we were saying. He's always existed as the Son of God. He became born of the Virgin Mary. The Mother of God, Theotokos, the God-bearer, according to the manhood, humanity. One and the same Christ, Son, Lord, only begotten, to be acknowledged in two natures, human and divine, inconfusedly, unchangeably, indivisibly, inseparably. The distinction of natures being by no means taken away by the union, but rather the property of each nature being preserved. That's not Apollinarianism. They didn't get blended into one different thing. And concurring in one person and one subsistence, not parted or divided into two persons. So it's not Nestorianism, not two beings, but one and the same Son and only begotten God, the Word, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now you see why we don't quote this. Because the Chalcedonian Creed, people kept coming up with either disagreeing with something that had already been decided or coming up with some version of it that was wrong. The Chalcedonian Creed is an effort to try to answer all of those problems at one time. And so buried in the Chalcedonian Creed is statements that address Apollinarianism and Arianism and, you know, Nestorianism and Eutychianism and et cetera, et cetera. All of them there. The bottom line, and this is what the hypostatic union means, that Jesus is both fully God and fully human. He has always been God. He became human when conceived in Mary, with no mixture or dilution of those two natures, forever united in one person. Got it? Now, I'm not saying there's not a mystery buried in that. How do you have a divine and human nature in one? In fact, that mystery, how do those two things, two natures exist in one without one overwhelming the other, is exactly what continues to be a problem, and that's the way in which Wayne Grudem gets it wrong, as we'll talk about in a few minutes. I want to refer to the Athanasian Creed, which is a little easier to read than the Chalcedonian Creed, but it establishes the same thing. This is what the Athanasian Creed. It's called Athanasian because it's credited to Athanasius, who was the guy who was primarily the opponent of Arius, leading up to the Nicene Council. But it's probable that it was written later and just attributed to him because it was stuff that he argued for. All right, and as part of it, it says this. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is God and man, perfect God and perfect man, who, although he is God and man, yet he is not two, but one Christ. One, not by conversion of the Godhead into flesh, but by taking or assuming of the manhood into God. Okay, yes, the Athanasian Creed is a little easier to read. Not quite as many, subordinate clauses. But you get the idea. This is what we believe as the fundamental truth of the nature of Jesus. Fully God, fully man, the hypostatic unit. Okay? Questions about that? All right, we're going to take a break. So we've established that Jesus was a divine nature and a human nature in one person, and that that occurred at the incarnation. All right. So we then have the issue of figuring out, as much as we can, and there is no perfect answer to this, how the divine and the human existed in one. We have clear indication that Jesus, the humanity of Jesus, you know, he was fully divine. He performed, I'll deal with that first. He performed all kinds of miracles. He stilled the storm. He raised the dead. He turned water into wine. Many of those are what are called nature miracles, meaning he affected the forces of nature by calming the storm, by converting, you know, the water to wine, by turning bread and, you know, multiplying the bread and the fishes. But Jesus performed all manner of miracle that demonstrated his power as the Son of God. And it was usually after those kind of demonstrations that people would acknowledge him as the Son of God. He had power far beyond what any person could have had. Now, Jesus performed those miracles for two reasons, we're told. One is to demonstrate his authority as the Son of God. It's the chain, they're raising the door next door. They opened it. The other reason he did it was out of compassion. The miracles of healing and the driving out demons, healing diseases, and of feeding, caring for the needs of people were all born out of his passion, or his pity and compassion for the people who were suffering, and also raising the dead. When he raised Lazarus, for instance, that's the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus is there with Mary and Martha, Lazarus's sisters, and they are all grieving. And the shortest verse in the Bible is Jesus wept. Well, he didn't cry, he didn't weep because Lazarus was dead, because he raises him from the dead just a few minutes later. Jesus wept out of compassion and pity for the suffering and the grief that the people who loved Lazarus went through at his death. Okay? So Jesus clearly demonstrated his divinity by his abilities while he was alive on earth. But he also experienced human emotions and human physical characteristics. He showed love, human love, compassion, anger, and grief as emotions. All of those very real human emotions. And then he had physical characteristics, human physical characteristics. He got tired. In fact, one of his great miracles of calming the storm happened because he was tired after a long day of ministry, and he and the apostles were sailing back across the Sea of Galilee, and he's so tired, it says, he fell asleep in the back of the boat. While he's asleep, this storm comes up, and the apostles freak out, and they're saying, "Lord, Lord, don't you care? We're about to drown!" And he gets up and calms the storm, and then he says, "You guys, what is wrong with you?" So his human tiredness prompted an event which led to the demonstration of his divine power, calming the storm. He slept, he hungered, he thirsted, he suffered pain, and ultimately he suffered death. God does not die, but Jesus died. So we struggle with exactly where the balance is between what aspect of him was human and what aspect of him was divine. And he clearly manifested both human and divine characteristics, abilities, inclinations throughout his whole life. Okay? Now, one of the things that Jesus experienced was temptation. You remember? Well, Jesus, I'll just make a statement. Jesus experienced real temptation, and he could have chosen to sin. I disagree with Wayne Grudem. Because if Jesus did not have the option of sinning, then it wasn't a real temptation. Now let me quote you here from Grudem. Grudem says, if Jesus, would you ask them, Guillermo, tell them we're very sorry, but they need to not come back and bother classes and church and stuff like that.
A different?
Okay. There's one family that comes almost every day at this time, okay? And I'm very compassionate. In fact, I've given them 100 times what it's worth for the fruit we're selling and stuff. But okay, Grudem says on page 539, if he's talked about the temptation and the fact that God can't, it says God cannot be tempted to evil. Scripture says that. But then he concludes, and by the way, that is the very question, is that what part of him is human, what was divine, how do those two things work? And he goes on at great length later on this. this. But this is the conclusion he draws first. He even says if Jesus couldn't have actually given in to the temptation and sin, then is it really temptation? Right question. But he comes up with the wrong answer, I think. He says, if Jesus as a person had sinned, involving both his human and divine natures in sin, then God himself would have sinned and he would have ceased to be God. Yet that is clearly impossible because of the infinite holiness of God's nature. Therefore, in my bold, I highlighted this, if we are asking if it was actually possible for Jesus to have sinned, it seems that we must conclude that it was not possible. I do not agree. In this, I believe Grudem is mistaken in that he favors the divine nature of Jesus at the expense of the human nature, while both are equally important. In other words, right here, Grudem makes an error that so many people have made. Rather than say, there's a mystery here and we don't understand exactly how all these fit together, he jumps further than he has to. In fact, if I would say Grudem has one fault, it's that when he's confronted with a mystery or challenge, he jumps to conclusions, he jumps further than he needs to. And here he says Jesus could not have sinned. Well, then he wasn't really tempted. And we are denying the full humanity of Jesus, meaning temptation and the potential for sinning, in order to try to say that he was fully divine. Now let me talk about that a little bit, okay? The definition of a temptation is an enticement or allurement, and this is from the New World Dictionary, it's not my definition, an enticement or allurement to do something, especially something morally wrong or unwise. So it's not a temptation unless it is an enticement to do something. And if Jesus couldn't do that thing, then how could it have been a temptation? No one can be tempted by something they cannot do. I am not tempted to become the Queen of England or to flap my arms and fly to the moon. Something that it is not possible for me to do, by definition, cannot really be a temptation to me. And yet Scripture tells us Jesus was tempted. Therefore, there must have been the potential for him to have actually given in to that temptation. The devil is no fool. We may not like him, but he's not stupid. So when he tempted Jesus in the desert, Matthew 4, there's parallel in Luke, it had to be with the expectation that he, the devil, might succeed in that temptation, or that whole pericope, that whole story, that whole event makes no sense whatsoever. The devil is a spiritual being. He knows how things work a lot better than we do, and he was tempting Jesus. He would not have done so if he did not think he had a chance of getting Jesus to give in to that temptation. Does that make sense? Grudem argues that Jesus could not have sinned because it would have violated his divine nature without recognizing that if the temptations were not real, that is, that Jesus could not fall into temptation, that would have violated Jesus' human nature. He jumps too far. Now, I will confess it's a mystery. And it may be, you know, he says, well, Grudem says, well, if Jesus had given into temptation, then his divine nature would have been wrapped up in that temptation. Well, we don't know that. We don't know exactly how those natures affect each other. We have an indication, but we don't know for sure. It may be that if Jesus, who was fully God and fully human, if he had given into temptation and sinned, the whole world may have evaporated instantaneously. We don't know what would have happened. All reality may have been subsumed, for all we know. The fact is, he didn't. He was tempted in all ways as we are, Hebrews says. And again, tempted in all ways as we are means he could have said, okay. Yet was without sin. He didn't sin. We don't know what would have happened to his divine nature and his human nature if Jesus had given in to temptation, but to say that he could not have sinned is theologically simply untenable.
So the devil, he was the highest angel in heaven, but because of his pride, what kind of nature did he have?
Okay, I don't want to get into the nature of demons and angels right now. We're talking about the nature of Jesus, okay? I don't want to get diffuse on that because this is a hard thing for people to try to pick up, okay? We dealt with angels and demons in a previous class, and I'll answer your question maybe later, Angie, but right now let's stick with this point, all right? Sorry.
Okay.
Florette.
Okay, so Jesus is part of God.
He is God.
He is God, and God is without sin. Mm-hmm. So if God is without sin, then God cannot be tempted. He can be given a temptation.
God, the Godhead, the Spirit of God, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, cannot be tempted. God cannot be tempted to evil.
Right.
But Jesus, in his incarnate form, experienced, we're told, experienced everything that we have, including temptation. My point is a temptation can't be a temptation by definition unless there's the potential of falling to it. You can't be tempted by something you can't do. And so I think there had to at least be the possibility that Jesus could have said yes to temptation. Now, again, I confess that knowing that God cannot be tempted to evil, I don't know what would have happened if Jesus had given in to temptation. Fortunately, he didn't, and so we'll never know. But to suggest that he couldn't have, on the theological sort of extrapolation that Grudem does, that because God couldn't sin, Jesus in his human nature couldn't sin either. And the interesting thing is, Grudem goes on and on and on, page after page, to try to identify the aspects of Jesus' human nature caused him to be tired and to, you know, to be hungry and to be, you know, grief-stricken, etc., etc. And his divine nature did this and this and this, recognizing there were some aspects that were affected or manifested through his human nature, and some that affected or manifest through his divine nature, and recognize that those things, you know, God cannot get tired, but Jesus got tired. God does not get hungry, but Jesus got hungry. God cannot experience pain, but Jesus experienced pain. How can we say all of that, which Grudem does, and then say, God cannot be tempted, so Jesus could not be tempted? The logic doesn't follow. Okay, back here first, and then back to you for it. Yes?
His last prayer, just before going to the cross, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me.
Right.
That's from his human nature saying, this is horrible. He laid aside his divinity, and he didn't act in his divine nature on his time on earth, because to do that would have negated his human nature. So he acted as a man, and he prayed constantly to God, and he did the miracles and so on through God and through the divinity,
right,
but not by his human power.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, and understand, I'm not saying God can be tempted or give in to temptation, but Jesus in his human nature did a whole lot of things God can't do, and to say that he couldn't have given in to temptation, the logic does not follow, the definitions don't follow to me. And I confess, I don't know what would have happened. Nobody knows what would have happened if Jesus had given in to the devil's temptations. As I say, the world, the universe might have been vaporized for all we know. But the fact that we don't know what would have happened if that divine paradox had been breached does not give us an excuse for violating what seems to me the only logical understanding of the temptation of Jesus. So Florette first, and then back to John.
Okay, so we're making the assumption, we're saying that physically his body could experience these things, but then to say that he could have been tempted or sinned would put him on the category of mentally being on our level, where his level of spirituality and his understanding was so much higher than ours.
He mentally was on our level. Now, he had access to levels we don't have access to, but when Jesus was born, when he was 3 months old, he did not speak a language. It says that he grew in wisdom and understanding. Jesus was not born with all knowledge as an infant. Now, granted, he was divine from the moment of his birth, and he had access to things that we will never conceive of. But part of God's plan was that he grew up and existed exactly as a human being. And I'll come back to you in a second, but I want to give you two more verses related to exactly this. Okay, there we go. This is Hebrews 2:14 to 18. I mentioned it in terms of the address a minute ago. This is what it says. Since the children, that's us, have flesh and blood, he, Jesus, too, shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. For surely it is not angels he helps, but Abraham's descendants. That's us. You know, we studying Romans in our Bible study, we just talked about the fact that uncircumcised and circumcised are all descendants of Abraham, okay, if we are of faith. Here it is. For this reason, he had to be made like them, fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, that he might make atonement for their sins to the people, because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. Now, how did he suffer when he was being tempted unless it was hard for him not to give in? And how could it have been hard for him not to give in if it was not possible for him to give in? And further on in Hebrews, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin. You cannot say that Jesus was tempted in every way same as we are if there was no danger of him giving into that temptation. He would not have suffered temptation, as it says in verse 18 of Hebrews 2. His temptation would not have been a suffering if he did not have to fight it, if he did not struggle with it, if he was not having difficulty with it. And how could it have been difficult if it was not possible for him to give in?
It's the definition of temptation.
Exactly.
So where's the sin nature of man?
I'm sorry, what?
If he could sin.
Well, he had the potential of sinning,
potential.
But didn't. And if I understand what you're saying, you're agreeing with this, that if he was fully human, then he had to have at least the potential for sinning. He did not. He didn't give in at any point in any way. And who knows what would have happened if he had. But to say it wasn't possible seems not only to violate every other discussion and argument about the human nature of Jesus, but it seemed to violate Scripture. So John first, and then Terry.
The whole purpose of this incarnation was that he would have a body that would suffer for what you and I deserve. Mm-hmm. And so that's the only reason he was given a body. And that's what that states right there in Hebrews.
Right.
And so the pain that we deserve because of our sin, he felt. The temptations that we encounter, but we fall to, he did not. He experienced, but did not fall to.
Right.
And so when you look at this divine mixture between God and man, it was for the purpose of ultimately going to the cross to pay the ultimate price for you and me. Mm-hmm. That's why sacrifices of bulls and goats no longer serve.
Right.
Because it had to be human. It had to be fully human to satisfy the atonement requirements of God.
Right.
And yet it had to be perfect. And there's no one on earth perfect but God himself. So you have the incarnation, you have God the Father, God, and you have humanity merged two in one here. You have this unique incarnation, and that satisfied the requirements of just Father.
But with Hebrews, when it says that, we do not have a great high priest who does not empathize, the point it's making is that when we suffer temptation, and we go to Jesus, he knows exactly what it feels like. I'm sorry, but if it was not possible for him to have given in, if there was no potential for him to have sinned, then he doesn't understand what I'm going through. And therefore, that would be wrong. And so that's why I don't believe Grudem got it right. Terry.
It's amazing that with our limited logic and understanding, we can still grasp most of this. I've got 2 points. One is curious about the translation of the word fully. And I don't expect you to respond to that, but I mean the word fully, to me, that's where I don't know if the translation from Hebrews or wherever else it may be used means the same thing now as it may have meant then. So.
Okay.
Words like truly I can go with. This goes back to my first point about logic and epistemology and how we come to know meaning and so forth. So that's just the word fully to me, truly is a little easier, or actually or really, but the word truly is where I get into difficulty.
Okay.
My second point is that if I think in mathematical terms in the Venn diagram, divine and human, it's the overlap that's really the mystery and the interesting part. If finding him as human, of course, we use the excellent example, finding him as divine, well, we are exposed to a little bit of that through what we have in Scripture, and we understand that. But it's the overlap, if there is an overlap, in Venn diagram way, that is where the mystery is.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what we're spending the time on today. But
and there is no good way to diagram that, by the way. I mean, the Gruden's book, they try to have all these diagrams.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, okay, Nestorianism, divine nature, human nature, you know, and then there's the mixed togetherness, you know, Apollinarianism and all that.
Yeah, and that's where logic or language or our understanding
is inadequate.
We bump against the wall,
maybe. We can't really come up with a diagram that is 100% one thing and 100% something else without merging the two together.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's very difficult.
Or mixing oil and water and
exactly.
So forth. But it's still the consequence of the two being together that's the interesting part, mm-hmm. the mysterious part.
Yeah. Chris first and then Marvin.
This is really interesting and it's enlightening and I like it. I'm just curious, like Burkhoff, Calvin, some of the others, do they sort of, is Gruden sort of echoing them or you know?
No, I don't think he is. I can't quote exactly the other Reformed theologians. I do not believe Calvin would maintain that Jesus could not have sinned. I can't quote that from the Institutes, but I don't think he would have. That's an interesting question. I need to go back and do a little more study on some of the other Reformed theologians like Calvin, Burkhoff, etc. But I think that Grudem does a good job of considering the options up to a point, and then he jumps to something he doesn't have to. It's okay to say, we don't know what would have happened if Jesus had given in to the devil's temptations or any other temptation in his life. But the fact that he truly was tempted, and Grudem himself says, the question is asked, how can it really be a temptation if you can't have given in to it? And so he asks all the right questions, and then he comes up with the wrong conclusion because he seemed to leap over where he should have stopped short and admitted, we don't know what would have happened, but logic and Scripture suggest to us that the potential was there for Jesus to have made a wrong choice. Marvin?
Jesus was the Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the earth. The whole focus is on him of all of creation and of all of this world. And God knew, mm-hmm. and through all of his temptation, that he wouldn't sin. We have a little precursor of that with Job, when God points out Job to Satan, and Satan, you know, and that terrible temptation and pressure that was put on him, but God knew. God knows everything and is in control of everything from up there.
Yeah.
That he's willing to put his son into a fleshly body, knowing what's there. That
right.
Jesus could sin, yes.
Well, see, and if Grudem made that argument, that, and there are problems with that argument, by the way.
Yeah.
If Grudem were to make the argument that God the Father and Jesus as the pre-incarnate Word knows perfectly what's going to happen and knew that he would not sin, and so therefore, because of that foreknowledge, there was no danger of him sinning, I would be more inclined to take that seriously than his conclusion that logically he couldn't have because God couldn't sin. I mean, that's a different argument, and one that I would probably be more open to considering than what Grudem actually says. And that he says, all this argument about, you know, Jesus being tempted and Jesus could have sinned, but God can't sin, so he couldn't either. And I'm going, whoa, way back up, you know? Florette.
I just want to say that if God was human and just tempted in every way just as we are, then there could be other people in this world that could be perfect too.
No.
Well, this is what it's saying. It's
no,
saying that
it's not.
He suffered because it says that he didn't give in to temptation. Is it not possible that as a human we could not give in to temptation in any way?
No,
we can't.
I'm just
the rest of Scripture says no, we can't.
It has to be more. It has to be more than he was just tempted in every way, just as we are. I'm saying there has to be so much more than that.
I'm not exactly sure where you're going, but Scripture is clear in saying that he is the only one who is the divine Word incarnate. So other people, there are not other beings like him out there. And that because he was the only incarnate one,
right.
He is the only one that was able to be without sin. The rest of the New Testament is very clear in saying there is no other created human.
I agree. So he had to have special powers that were beyond being.
Oh, I agree with that. That's the divine part. Yeah.
Right.
Now,
but, Okay.
In fact, you're leading to the next point I want to make,
okay.
which is where I, the second place I disagree with Grudem, and I'm not trying to pick on him. Again, I think this is very useful because it allows us to struggle with these issues and understand why we believe what we believe instead of just sort of taking it all in. It's good for us to say, no, I don't think so, based not on what I think. You know, well, I don't like that, so therefore I don't believe it. You know? It's what does Scripture say, and what does reason tell us? And if I didn't have any Scripture to back what I'm saying, and Grudem did, I'd go, well, he must be right, even though I don't quite get that. But I don't think he's right. Now, the other thing that Grudem talks about and dismisses almost out of hand is the kenosis idea that taken from Philippians 2. And this is, and I'll say this, this is my statement, that Jesus did, in fact, set aside some of his divine power, which is the concept of kenosis. Kenosis is Greek from the kinu, the verb to set aside. That Jesus did, in fact, set aside some of his divine power when he became incarnate. Grudem says no. But then Grudem goes into all this stuff about how it was his human nature that got hungry and got tired and got, you know, angry and grieved and all that. And I'm thinking, okay. Now, Philippians 2, this is the passage that's the basis of the kenosis idea, that Jesus set aside some of his divine power. And I'm going to give you this verse in two translations, and then I'm going to give you an analogy. Hopefully they'll help you understand where I'm coming from on disagreeing with Grudem. Philippians 2:5, this is from, I think this is English Standard Version. Have this mind among you then, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing. Some translations said, but emptied himself or poured himself out or set it aside, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Now, I'm going to give you one other translation, then I'm going to come back to this one. This is from The Message. This is Eugene Peterson's version, and it is a translation, it's not a paraphrase. So he bases this on the original language. He writes, "Think of yourselves the way Christ Jesus thought of himself. He had equal status with God," meaning with God the Father, "but didn't think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantages of that status no matter what. Not at all. When the time came, he set aside," that's kenosis, "he set aside the privileges of deity and took on the status of a slave, became human." Taking on the status of a slave, became human. "Having become human, he stayed human. It was an incredibly humbling process. He didn't claim special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless, obedient life and then died a selfless, obedient death, and the worst kind of death at that, a crucifixion." Now, Grudem's point is that if Jesus set aside any of his divine power, he became less divine. He became less God if he set aside any of his divine power. Now, traditionally, the kenosis idea, and by the way, Grudem's history is wrong too, because he says this was first developed in the 1800s by a German philosopher. St. John of the Cross wrote about this in the 1500s. Okay, so it's earlier than Grudem thinks. Grudem says if Jesus, and traditionally, the idea was that Jesus was no longer, when he became incarnate, he set aside, not lost, but voluntarily set aside his omniscience, his omnipresence, and his all-powerfulness, okay, omnipotence. That didn't mean in terms of, this is another passage. When Jesus is asked about the final day, the last day, when will it all end? He says, about that day or hour, Jesus says, about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Jesus is admitting there is something he doesn't know, which means he's admitting that he is not omniscient. Right? How else do you read that? Well, come back to this translation. The mistake that Grudem makes here is, again, he jumps further than he has to. He assumes that if Jesus set aside, and again, voluntarily is an important word to me, if he voluntarily set aside his omnipresence, he wasn't everywhere at once when he was in the physical body, his omniscience, he didn't know everything, as he admitted in Mark, and his omnipotence, okay, now that one is harder because he could have done anything. He did a lot of powerful things. calming storms, raising dead, turning water to wine, etc. I'll give you an analogy here. Suppose I come up and there's a pen full of puppies, you know, very cute little things, and I step over into the pen, and because I want to relate to the puppies, I sit down. And I got puppies climbing all over me, and I'm petting them, but I'm being very careful that I don't hurt them because they're just tiny puppies. The fact that I have reduced myself down in order to be able to relate to them, I'm not using all my strength because I could hurt them. I'm not using all my height because I wouldn't be able to relate to them. I get down where they are and I treat them very gently. I don't use all my power. That doesn't mean I'm not really as tall as I am, nor that I've lost my strength. I have chosen, for the sake of relating to a weaker, cuter, cute little bunch of creatures, to voluntarily not use all my strength. I have set that aside in order to be able to relate to these weaker beings. Grudem's mistake is that he thinks if Jesus voluntarily set these things aside, he lost them, or he no longer could have accessed them. In some way, he stopped being as divine. No. He proves when he calms the storm and raises the dead, he proves that he still can reach out and access those things and use them, but that he has voluntarily chosen to sit down and gently relate to these weaker creatures. Not that he has actually lost any of his divinity or any of his power, but he has, and I believe that's what it says here, he made himself nothing, taking the form of servant, being born in the likeness of men. He got down on our level. He set part of that aside. Grudem is wrong in thinking if you believe that, it means he's less God. That's not necessary. He goes too far in his assumptions there. Does that make sense? You understand my analogy there? I believe that the kenosis passage in Philippians is the explanation for how Jesus experienced humanity while still being fully divine. He simply didn't use all of his strength. You know, when I'm, well, I could come up with a lot of analogies. You know, how do you carry an egg? You don't do that to it. You don't use all your strength. It's not going to work. I think that's how Jesus related to us. Not that he lost it, his power, but he set it aside for a while. He simply didn't use it. He chose not to access, except when he was doing a miracle. And then he could access as much power as he needed. John, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I just want to say, to me, one of the evidences that he laid aside his kenosis is he consistently invites us to do what he did.
Right.
Raise the dead, heal the sick, cast out devils, preach the gospel, be kind to the poor.
Yep.
He's constantly inviting us to do what he did. And we cannot do the kenosis. I mean, we are humans.
Yep.
And so, to me, that's an evidence right there that he laid these superior divine attributes aside temporarily.
Didn't lose them. And he didn't, no longer, he didn't lose access to them. He could still access them when he needed to.
That was the humility.
Exactly. And that's the whole point of this, is the passage, which again I think Grudem misinterprets that. He says, well, this is not talking about his divine power because he's telling the Philippians that you should be humble, like Jesus was humble. Well, the way he was humble is that he didn't claim all of the things he could have claimed, including his powers. Pardon?
God's way of setting things aside is probably much more complicated than anything we could conceive of. But I'm thinking of this TV program where the president of the company will go and dress up as the delivery person or the pizza maker or whatever and be like the new employee with the other employees.
Yep.
And find out what they think of the company and how, what kind of workers they are and all these kind of things. And he's not the boss and he doesn't have power for that period of time.
So that he can relate to them, because if he were the boss, he would not be able to relate to them on their level.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean he stopped being the boss. He just took on a different role while he was working with them. Yes, Joan.
If Jesus hadn't been limited to a certain extent, even in his knowledge and understanding, then he would have been just play acting as a human being. Yeah. He wouldn't have really been a human being.
Correct.
I mean, when he was in the garden and he was in agony, if he had complete understanding of everything, he would have had complete peace, and that whole agony thing wouldn't be necessary at all. And when he was dying and he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Which for a long time really worried me. why should Jesus feel that he was forsaken by God? But if he hadn't gone through that, then we wouldn't be able to believe that he understood us, because at times we also feel forsaken by God.
Right.
And I don't think Jesus had to go through all that so that he could understand us. I think he went through all that so that we could relate to him, so that I would believe that this divine being that I can't even conceive could actually understand me. Because otherwise, I would not believe that for a minute.
That's what Hebrews says. We do not have a great high priest who is unsympathetic to our weakness, but rather one who has been tempted in all ways, even as we are, yet without sin. So you're exactly right. And again, my sense is that because Grudem denies the potential for Jesus to have given it to temptation, and he denies the kenosis, these two things actually answer each other. But denying both of those, he leaves himself in a quandary, in my mind. The fact that, you know, how is it that Jesus could potentially really have sinned? Now, we don't know what the result would have been if he had sinned, but it's because he had set aside some of his divine powers. Now, he could still access it when he needed to, but he had voluntarily, as a show of humility, to relate to us weaker creatures, to be one of us, had set aside some aspects of his divine power to relate to us. And I think one of the things that tells us is that Jesus, that's how Jesus could be tempted, and how he potentially, he didn't, praise God, but he could have actually given in to those temptations, because there were parts of his divine authority and power that he had voluntarily, and that word's important, voluntarily set aside. Nothing was taken from him. He didn't lose it. He didn't throw it away so that he didn't have access anymore to it. He simply took it and he put it where he wouldn't access it unless he really needed it for the sake of miracles or whatever. Okay? Yes, Wendell?
I think you just answered my question just now, but I had a little trouble between the temptor and the temptee here, that God, Christ is God, and God cannot be tempted.
Correct.
But people can tempt him anyway. You know, there could still be tempters out there, but he being can't be the temptee.
Mm-hmm. You mean God cannot be the one that's tempted?
No, I'm saying that people can do things, they can tempt, but God cannot be tempted.
Right.
So there it's meaningless.
Okay.
Their temptation. Their tempt is not.
It's not going to sink in.
It just
God.
Goes against a black wall.
Right. Against God, the Godhead. I mean, against God, who is spirit. But there's something, because Jesus took on the human aspect, the challenge we have is, if he really took on the human aspect, then he was possible. It was possible. Because Scripture says over and over again, he was tempted.
Yep. Well, when you say he put aside the human part of him.
No. He put aside the divine part. He set aside his divine power.
I meant the divine part. Did that include not being able to be tempted?
No, I don't think so, because it says he was tempted. We're told over and over again he was tempted.
He was tempted, but he couldn't be tempted.
Yeah, he could. The human side of him could be tempted. And that's it. He has two natures, the divine and the human. Scripture says the divine can't be tempted, but the human side was definitely tempted. The question is whether the human side could have given in to
temptation. So when you put the divinity of him, he took that aside, he could also put that aside.
Only some of the power of divinity. He set aside some of his divine power when he became incarnate. He set aside his omniscience. He admits in Mark that he doesn't know everything. He does not know the hour of the day, of the consummation, etc. So only part of his divine authority or power did he set aside. And he could still access it, as demonstrated by the fact that he could do miracles. Okay? All right. You get the idea. And again, it's important. I'm not slighting Wayne Grudem. I'd love to talk to him about this stuff. But I think the book is really excellent. I think that it's important that when we read this stuff, we have the ability to say, wait a minute, I don't agree. I don't agree with your evaluation of whether Jesus could actually have sinned. I don't agree with your evaluation of the kenosis passage. And you all don't have to agree with me, by the way. You know, you can agree with Grudem if you wish. But I want you, almost more than the content here, the process of what we've just been doing, of sorting things out and looking at Scripture and saying what, based on what Scripture says, what makes sense, is important. That's what it means to be a theologian. And you're all theologians. Anyone who's ever made a profession of faith is a theologian. You're either a good theologian or a bad theologian. And when you're involved in this kind of process, you become a better theologian. So that's why that's important.
Can you imagine the conflict that these councils had when they hammered all this out? I mean, we're just like this right here in this little classroom, but these guys, boy, yeah, they were dealing with the evidence of
Theologians. I think it was it Athanasius that was deposed from his bishop's position 5 times? Because the ebb and flow of, you know, whose belief is dominant right now. Yeah. 5 different times he would be deposed, and then later on his side would gain the forefront again, and they'd bring him back and say, we're really sorry about that, and then things the tides would change again of doctrine, and he would be deposed again 5 different times. I think that was Athanasius. So
I think so.
Linda first, and then your faith.
But the fact that God knows the heart and the mind, and at that point, Christ answered immediately and didn't see him under any stress. When it was seemed like his reading, that it was immediate that he rejected the temptation. Mm-hmm. So, but he had to have known the mind and heart of the devil. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
So, well, yeah, I think so. I have to think about that. Okay.
Well, that's yeah. All I have.
Okay. Just, Grace?
Reading on there.
Faith. I'm sorry. Grace, faith. You're one of those values. Sorry. I'm calling you Grace, faith. I'm sorry.
The statement is made that when we are tempted, we fall into the temptation because of our sin nature.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Where is that?
James talks about we are enticed right after that verse.
Okay.
It talks we are tempted when we are enticed. It says, God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one, but each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire.
Okay.
Is that what you
mean? By his own desire.
Uh-huh. And desire when it conceives.
So one could raise the question, then, if Christ could have sinned, did he have the potential of a sin nature?
Okay, well, that in translation did not say sin nature.
No,
said desire.
It says enticed.
Okay, enticed by desires. So there'd be a question in translation, I think.
So, or the statements that are made, we sin because of our sin nature. Some have said that.
Yeah. Okay, I'm not going to get in. You know, we're opening a whole different kind of worms here. But again, this you can disagree with me on this stuff, but this is how I, as a theologian, respond to theological question. Terry, did you have something?
No, that's the
okay. All right. If you haven't read Grudem, you now have something exciting to deal with. You can go back and read him and see what he says about this stuff.
Rich. I see where Jesus really put it away his divine nature is when he was crucified.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he agreed not to do that. But I still think when he went through all that, he was still tempted.
Yeah. Well, he was, in the garden when he said, if it be your will, let this pass from me. That would be a kind of temptation. And again, with Grudem's statement about, well, he couldn't sin because God can't sin. Well, God can't die. God can't get tired. God can't do any of the things that Jesus absolutely manifests. And he says, well, it was his human side that did those things, not his divine side. Well, then say the same thing about the potential he had for sinning, that his human side could have sinned, and maybe the universe would have exploded at that point. But again, there's an inconsistency there, I think. So if you haven't read it already, read it and see what you think. All right, I want to do a couple more things in the next 10 minutes, not spend much time on it. One is I want to talk a little bit about the titles for Christ, because I think they're important, and he talks about that a little bit. Jesus obviously had the title Christ. Most people think that's his last name, Jesus Christ. Christ is the Greek version of the word Messiah, which is a transliteration of Mashiach, the Hebrew word. Both of those words, Christ and Messiah, which is the same thing in Greek and Hebrew, mean the anointed one. An anointed one means the king. The king is anointed. Those of you who have been in our Old Testament history classes, you know, God appointed Samuel to go and find Saul and anoint him. In fact, if you look at an icon Samuel, the prophet Samuel, he always has a horn. Why is that? It's because they carried oil in a horn that looks like a cow's horn. That's what they can carry oil in, and the anointing oil would have been kept in a horn. So Samuel's image in icons has always got a horn. So The anointed one, the Christ, the Messiah, establishes Jesus as the fulfillment of the Jewish expectation for God's promised King and Redeemer. From very early in the history of the Hebrew people, certainly Moses even earlier, the Jews were promised that a Messiah, an anointed one, would come and that he would be the one sent by God to relieve them from the oppression of their enemies, to establish the kingdom of God on earth. And so Christ or Messiah or anointed one as a title for Jesus is an indication that he is the fulfillment of the millennia-long expectation of the Jews. Right? Now, the testimony in the New Testament about Jesus, Peter's sermons, a lot of what Paul says, probably more than any other, the sermon and testimony of Stephen before he's martyred, all of them go back to the Old Testament and the prophetic expectation for a Messiah to come. And they argue from that Old Testament earliest prophecies all the way through to Jesus as being the fulfillment of that. That is why he is Jesus Christ to us, Jesus the Anointed One, the Messiah, because he fulfills all of God's promise throughout all of time. Okay? Another title that is used for him commonly is Kyrios, which is the Greek word for Lord. This is the most common title for that Paul uses. He refers to Jesus as Kyrios more than any other thing. It was one of the most common titles for Jesus in the early church. That may have been because there were more churches planted by Paul, there was more of the early church because of Paul than any other single source. Inherent in this idea of Lord is the implication of deity, of pre-existence, of absolute lordship. Lord was commonly used by pagans to refer to whichever god they worshipped. You know, the people who worshipped Artemis of Ephesians would call her Lord, etc. And so it always implies deity, a divinity. So when it was assigned to Jesus, it is a symbol that he is the divine one. Okay? And as I say, it's the most common title in Paul's writing and amongst Gentile Christians especially. You can find it in several places. A third name that's common for Jesus, and I mentioned this one, I could use other titles, but this one because there's a reason for it, but it also got us in trouble sometimes. Jesus, Friend of Sinners, is a name that became popular in the Middle Ages or the medieval times. The reason for that was because there began to be a desire to think of Jesus in a friendlier way than being, you know, the Son of God on the throne of judgment. You know, there had been a history of thinking of him as almost a militant figure. And during the Middle Ages, during the birth and growth of Romanticism, there was a move toward a softening of things. See, we think of romance, you know, love poetry and all that, because every song in English has love in it, and every song in Spanish has corazón in it. We think that that's always been the case. Romantic love was invented in the early Middle Ages in terms of it being a literary theme, a musical theme, etc. And it was during that same time of the development of romance and of the softening of perspectives that they began to think of Jesus, Friend of Sinners. But the problem, and that's fine, because he is the Friend of Sinners. But the problem is that that slowly evolved to the point where there's no longer any judgment involved. There's no longer any expectations. There's no responsibilities. He's just gentle Jesus, sweet and mild. Well, not the Jesus I read about in the New Testament, thank you. He does love sinners. He usually loves sinners more than he loves religious people in the New Testament. But that doesn't mean he is also not the Lord and God. Okay? And so there was that tendency in the Middle Ages to think of him in a much softened degree. That's where we began to get all these images of Jesus looking like a Scandinavian, you know, blonde hair and blue eyes and soft skin. The guy was he was Jewish, and he worked outside. He was a carpenter. He worked with his hands. He would have been a rough character probably in terms of visually. A man of labor, a man who worked in the sun, who walked in the sun, who walked hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles. This whole sort of wimpy, blonde, blue-eyed, I'm not speaking against blonde, blue-eyed people, my wife's name, so I'm not going to speak against the Scandinavians, but the idea of picturing Jesus only that way and sort of, you know, limp, that came from a medieval perception of him trying to soften it. Now, there are three other titles that we need to realize because they carry very specific significance in terms of Jesus his perception, how he presented himself and how other people saw him. The first of those, and these are called the sonship titles. There are three sonship titles of Jesus. The first one is, of course, the Son of God. We hear this referred to a lot. Mark 1:1 says, the beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. John 11, yes, Lord, she replied, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world. And I'm going to read you, well, I'll do that in a minute. And so the idea of Son of God, I said, you know, the apostles, when they identified him as the Son of God, when Peter was asked, when Jesus asked Peter, who do you say that I am? You are the Christ, Messiah, remember a minute ago? The anointed king, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus never refused that title. He never corrected anybody who called him the Son of God, even though he did not usually use that title for himself. But it is consistently used of him to his face, and he never does anything but affirm it. Okay? Now, the second title that Jesus, the sonship title, is the Son of Man. Now, the Son of Man is the title Jesus most often uses for himself. And it is true that some Old Testament prophets, Ezekiel, for instance, refers to himself as the Son of Man, which means he's one of the gods, he's a person. People often, and I've heard it said myself, people will say, oh, Jesus never claimed to be the Son of God, said he was the Son of Man. Well, any Jew that heard Jesus refer to himself as the Son of Man would have known where that comes from. It comes from the 7th chapter of Daniel, and a vision that Daniel has of the Ancient of Days, which is my favorite name for God, the Ancient of Days. And it says, in my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. That's what the Son of Man means. And I think the Jews that heard Jesus call himself the Son of Man knew what he was referring to. Okay? So Son of Man was Jesus' favorite title for himself. And there's lots of reasons why I think that would have been his favorite title. This is one, the biggest reason. It's also true that one of Jesus' concerns throughout his 3-year ministry was that things unfold in the order and in the time in which they were supposed to. Jesus was very careful not to have people rise up and declare him the Messiah and the King too early. In fact, in the book of Mark, especially the Gospel of Mark, there's what's called the hidden messiahship. Every time Jesus heals or drives out a demon from a Jewish person, almost every time, he says, now don't tell anybody. He never says that when he heals a Gentile. But with the Jews, he knew there was a danger. There was so much pent-up frustration with the Romans and with waiting for the Messiah. There was a real fear that if word got out and spread too quickly, too far, about the miraculous things Jesus was doing, an enormous crowd of Jews would grab him and put him on their shoulders and march into Jerusalem and declare him to be the king. And it wasn't time for that yet. And so we have the hidden messiahship. One reason Jesus may have called himself the Son of Man is intentionally because it wasn't as obvious as if he had called himself the Son of God. Because there was a timing issue here. The third sonship title is the Son of David, which actually is very similar to the Christ title, the Anointed One, because both of them suggest the place Jesus has in terms of the promise of God through Jewish history. The Son of David, Matthew 15, a Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him crying out, Lord, Son of David, because if she was a Canaanite woman, she knew he was a Jew, and descendant of David. Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly. And in Mark 10, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. When Jesus is called the Son of David, it's like calling him the Messiah. It means you are heir to the promise that was given to David, that a son of David, an heir of David, would always sit on the throne of Israel, and that the Messiah, the promised one of God, would come from the line of David. And so Son of David is very much a messianic kind of declaration. Finally, and I'm just going to put all this up here, it's helpful to us, and again, Grudem does a good job of this. The roles of Jesus can be thought of in terms of prophet, priest, and king. Understanding that a prophet is one who speaks the word of God to the people. In other words, God speaks through the prophet to the people. Jesus both spoke the words of God, and he was the incarnate word of God. So he was prophet in that regard. Although he's not called prophet in the New Testament, he served that function. Then there was priest in the Old Testament. A priest faced in the other direction. Whereas a prophet spoke to the people for God, a priest spoke to God for the people. A priest would pray on behalf of the people and would sacrifice on behalf of the people. So a prophet spoke to the people, a priest spoke to God for the people. Jesus prays for us as our one mediator. There is one God and one mediator between God and man, which is Christ Jesus the Lord. And he himself was the ultimate sacrifice once for all, typo. Ultimate sacrifice once for all. He himself was the sacrifice and the one who prays for us as the priest did. And finally, he was the king. The king is one in the history of the Israelites, the one who leads the people by God's anointing and in God's name. Saul was anointed by Samuel. David was anointed by Samuel. Okay. The kings were anointed. Solomon, anointed by Nathan, the prophet. And so the king was anointed to serve God by ruling over the people in God's name. Jesus is the King eternal who will rule forever. Jesus is the prophet who speaks to us the word of God and is the word of God. He is the priest who speaks on our behalf to God and offers the ultimate sacrifice on our behalf to God. And he is the king, the anointed one, the Christ, the Messiah, who is anointed by God and will rule in God's name, as he is himself the second person of the Godhead. Okay? We're out of time, so I can't deal with those things much more, but Grudem does a pretty good job of dealing with prophet, priest, and king, and those are three very important roles. Any questions?